Like a brief introduction of our guest today, we have Sasha Roesler. Sasha is an architect and architectural theorist. Sasha works at the intersection of architecture, ethnography, science, and technology studies. Sasha is an associate professor at the Academy of Architecture of Mendrisio, the Università della Svizzera Italiana. And some of his publications for us are like fundamental, actually formative. His book from 2018, The Urban Microclimate as Artifact, was so important for our practice. And his most recent books, they're also laying in our office, and we're actually studying them like on a daily basis. At the end of last summer, we had the chance of having this excursion of his students through Warsaw, and today we're going to see the outcome of this fantastic seminar that was called, in fact, Energy Landscape and Energy Transitions. And just before we start, I would like to actually name and thank them personally, because they, in fact, they are the protagonists of today. So let me just not miss anyone out. Thank you, Gloria, Francesco, Henry, Sibel, Tizien, Carol, Luigi, Justin, Sofia, Jan, Matilde, Ukash, which is actually here, Anna, Maria, Gautier, Dennis, Casper, and Davide. Sasha, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. It's really exciting to be here, also to be back. It's quite an experiment, I must say, to present now the outcome of a seminar. Usually this is not for the public, I must say, but I think it's really great to continue the conversation that we have started 1 year ago with friends here. Most of them are here, so also contributor to the seminar, and I think at the end of the presentation, we will have a joint discussion. So I really hope everything will work. And again, I apologize for the inconvenience. Now I should have the presentation. And maybe we can also lower the light, if possible. So as I said, I will basically present one of our key topics that we kind of that we are dealing with in Mendrisio at the Academy of Architecture. So this is energy landscape. Of course, energy is a key topic for societies, but also for architecture. And Warsaw was a very, I think, interesting case study for us to kind of develop this topic further. So now I also need this. Okay, just to maybe say a few words about our work. So we are a chair for architectural theory. The title is Theory of Urbanization and Urban Environments. And we are particularly, focusing on, this is kind of a dia show now. Can you stop that? Okay, so thanks. So we are particularly concerned with environmental issues in architecture, so energy topic, but also climate. And 4 years ago, we started to develop this framework of energy landscape with a seminar, the CTS Energy Landscape, followed by also a lecture series with quite prominent, scholars involved, Dipesh Chakrabarty, for instance, or James Wines, or Eva Horn, or also Matthew Gandhi, where we addressed different aspects of today's energy, discussion, focusing on world ecology, carbon cities, climate control, energy infrastructures, embodied energy, energy governance. So big topics. And the question is how architects and architecture in general as a profession can deal with these more and more important questions, As Simone said, we had a particular interest in urban climate topics in the last few years. We had a 6-year research project on architecture and urban climates, and of course also constantly referring to energy issues. Of course, climate and energy are kind of siblings and interrelated. So what I'm going to do now is first of all introducing this seminar, specifically the overall framework, so the notion of energy landscape, followed by some hints on our method, so how the students were investigating the city of Warsaw. And I will also include a few hints focusing on Geneva, another city that we have studied. And then in the second part, this is really kind of the center of this event, are 4 video essays that have been created by students groups addressing different topics of the energy landscape of Warsaw. So one group was focusing on the district heating system of Warsaw, which is of course in the most important, let's say, infrastructure of the city. Then a second group was reflecting on the possibility to create a public air-conditioned environment. Then a third group was focusing on using natural forces within design processes, focusing on this on the Warszawianka sports complex. And then the fourth group that we would like to include was focusing on the district of MDM, is that correct? So highlighting planning for solar access. And then I hope you will stay until the end. We'll have a joint discussion with some of our also presenters during the seminar. So Adam Brzywara is also here, Gosha and Simone of this great research collective Centrala, and Monika Konrad unfortunately is not here, but Anna Ptak is here, one of our students is here, and I think we will have a nice joint discussion. Okay, so let me quickly introduce now this notion of energy landscape, how we see it for architecture. Why should we talk about energy landscape and not only energy? So this is maybe the question. I think, first of all, we have to think about how architects and architecture as a discipline has framed the topic of energy in the last few decades. So first of all, I think the most important aspect has been that architects were exclusively focusing on individual buildings, right? So they were concerned with buildings, but not larger urban environments, and kind of trying to understand the energy dynamics, let's say, between buildings and across buildings. So here are 2 of the maybe seminal publications representing this type of theory. On the one hand, Peter Rainer Banham's book, The Architecture of the Well-Tempered Environment, highlighting power-operated solutions in architecture, so the well-tempered environment. And on the other hand, Hassan Fathi and his famous book, Natural Energy and Vernacular Architecture, promoting structural solutions, passive types of solution, how we can deal with the climate. So a really, we would say, contrasting approaches, but nevertheless highlighting individual buildings and not other scales, let's say, of energy. And also the ecology movement, as it evolved since the 1960s, was very much concerned with the individual, the privatized, right? But not with the city, the bad city in the back. So self-sufficient buildings for a family, but not really rethinking the city, right, as a broader framework of energy. So, and also the labels and thermal standards as they emerged in the last decades were very much, of course, promoting energy efficiency of the individual building without taking into account ambient energy and, again, broader frameworks, urban scales for energy. So that's why we really think landscape and energy is kind of a dynamic pairing, so we would like to look at landscape through the energy lens or urban landscapes. That's what we aimed for in the frame of our seminar, and also vice versa, of course, looking at energy through the landscape lens, so to speak. And since several decades yet, I think there is kind of emerging interest in this kind of urban understanding of infrastructural issues, but more specifically energy issues. So the notion of urban landscape that has been coined after the war in Berlin, right? A completely flattened city with a lot of green spaces and forests in between. So Hans Scheraun and Hertha Hammerbach were kind of developing this notion of urban landscape. We could also refer to urban scholar André Corbeau, who coined this idea of the territory as palimpsest, so a three-dimensional layered kind of territory, also with, let's say, energy infrastructures included. Historian Thomas Hughes was promoting and developing large technological systems, which is, of course, an important idea to understand the energy dynamic within cities. And then more recently, a debate in the social sciences on landscapes of energy. And as I said, we also try to kind of promote this idea in the last few years. So here are some slides. Hans Scheraun's idea of the urban landscape, kind of a view of a greenish type of urban environment after the Second World War. We could also refer, of course, to Warsaw, also promoting, in a way, similar ideas. Jerzy Soltan and his brilliant team, and Jerzy Soltan was a member of SIEM, of course, also reflecting new ideas on the mega form, we could say, kind of forming the landscape instead of building buildings, so to speak. So also a new type of ecological, proto-ecological thinking, we could say, emerging in Eastern Europe after the war. And then, as I said, the ecology movement, also with bottom-up solutions in the city, on the left in Lower East Side in New York, so early attempts to kind of gain solar access via solar panels, right, for water, for the heating of water. And then, and I think maybe more important now for our discussion, new types of microgrids emerging, for instance, in Brooklyn, New York, in recent time, really. So not only the individual homeowner having a photovoltaic on the rooftop, but kind of using a group of people kind of forming a new type of network, right? And using the internet and blockchain for clearing, so to speak. So I think this is an important development, a collective understanding and a decentralized understanding of energy use in the city. And then an example from Switzerland, a very recent discussion also in the context of climate change with less and less snow in the mountains. So there's a discussion how to cover highways with photovoltaic panels, so kind of a second layer on top of highways, a new coding, so to speak, of transportation routes. And also the slopes of the mountains are now discussed as new sites of huge solar farms in Switzerland. So I think we will really see now a new type of harvesting emerging in many countries in Europe. So, and then I would like to say a few words, of course, also about the specificities of energy in the city. So not only energy in general. And first of all, I would like to remind you in the most important aspect of 20th century energy system, and this was, of course, the idea of having a global energy hinterlands. So the city centers globally are depending on hinterlands, and here's just one example, Tony Garnier's famous Cité Industrielle, also with dams in the back, right, so providing energy for the city center. But in general, of course, cities are depending on remote places. Hermann Sergel's idea of kind of a new energy infrastructure for entire Europe, still in a, of course, colonial context, we could say, developed in the 1920s and 30s. Or, of course, a Soviet type of understanding of really not only exploiting nature, but completely transforming it, right? Kind of refabricating, restructure nature. And this is just one example of kind of ideas developed by Stalin. So how to kind of restructure the territory with new energy infrastructures. And of course, also the modernist ideas on the city are coined by infrastructural thinking also, or more specifically, energy infrastructure. So kind of a three-dimensional city, or represented in vertical sections, we could say, and generated by infrastructure. This is, of course, widely the city of the 20th century. These illustrations are taken from Alvin Boyarsky's issue on the city as energy system. And then also as an iconic building like Farnsworth House by Mies van der Rohe has to be reconsidered outside of Chicago, has to be reconsidered in light of energy hinterlands, of course. This is a completely overheated building. So it has too much glass, so to speak, and it uses air conditioning for cooling down the interior, right? So although we can't see it here, but I think it's very important now to very critically assess these, let's say, icons of modernist thinking in architecture. So energy is, of course, a very critical, not only technical topic, and I simply would like to remind you, there are many discussions also in conceiving energy as energo power. So we are talking about mechanical and electric power on the one hand, but also about institutional, political, and economic power. At the same time, when we are talking about energy, then also different components of energy. Of course, technological ones, but also the actors are important, the flows, so the resources, energy itself, the money, and so on. And I mentioned the scale. So we can't only focus today on the individual building, but we have to kind of reconsider energy on different, on new scales, on urban scales. So here are also some of the, let's say, materialities that we discussed in our seminar. We talked about energy systems, but also the relationship between centralized and decentralized solutions, and then also politics and norms play an important role. So I think city can really play a critical role in promoting energy transition. This is, I think, clear. There are a lot of, promising examples. At the same time, we also have to see that there are contrasting tendency with, a geopolitical dimension, which are in sharp contrast to the promotion of low carbon strategies. So there's really now a struggle, I think, for many also city administrations to find a way to do it on their own, so to speak. And of course, also Poland is a good example with its entire dependency on coal, right? And there's a cultural dependency and so on and so forth. We also discussed this last year. So just a few words about how we also assessed energy transition as such, as a concept. And I think for us as architects and also as educators at a architectural faculty, the most important idea is to make cities more productive in terms of energy. So, and that's why I really like to share this quote with you by Dean Hawkes, talking about productive energy landscapes. So he said, the city that produces all of the energy it needs for its buildings and the urban infrastructure is, of course, only a vision. To take the first steps towards its realization would transform the agenda for research and practice in architecture more radically than any idea since the advent of the modern movement, end of quote. So I think it's, this is a program and I think in a way also in our seminar we try to follow this path of thinking. So in this sense we also have to talk about new infrastructure in the context of renewable energy sources, new type of infrastructural modernity, we could say. You are certainly familiar also with these different components that are currently widely discussed. Of course, the question of new, low carbon or renewable energy farms, wind farms, solar farms, the question of location also. Then the question of energy storage. This is a completely unsolved problem, as you all know. So where to store and how to store electricity. The emergence of new microgrids, as I already mentioned it, as a possibility to kind of establish a decentralized type of energy provision. Data, of course, and the question also of smartness, smart city solution. And then, of course, also there are solutions on a building scale, heat pumps, etc. So I think the important thing is really to rethink the landscape in terms of energy. So what is within the city? And what is outside of the city if we start to think about rethinking a non-carbon energy future, right? So it's about a combination of centralized and decentralized sources, certainly. And again, just to give you also two examples, what are the implications for urbanism, for urban development? An old image taken from Ludwig Hilbesheimer's book, The New City, kind of a non-figurative type of urbanism, we could call it, a term used by Charles Waldheim. So a territory coined by infrastructure, by productive site, but not really urban from a city perspective. And then on the other hand, of course, a figurative type of urbanism coined by buildings, existing buildings. Take Warsaw as an example, and the question how we have to retrofit it, how we have to transform it, how we have to adapt it in light of energy transition. So I think decentralization and centralization are an important or one of the key topics that have to be discussed in light of energy transition. And also, of course, grey energy. Take a battery of a car and its production sites, which are global, and the distribution chains, right? The supply chains for all the components, and then how we use it maybe in Warsaw, the electric car at the end. So, I mean, to really reach the goal of a net zero emission city, we can't think that at currently, I would say. It's too complex. It's an enormous challenge, right, to really become net zero. And I also would like to mention the tensions between different goals. There are conflict goals. So on the one hand, to provide low carbon energy sources, but then on the same time, remain affordable for wide strata of the society. This is a key problem in Poland, as I learned, or as I know, of course, and then also to secure energy provision at the same time. So this is really a trilemma or a dilemma, how to achieve this. And we could also put it in another way, another diagram saying similar things. So there is a strong conflict between economic growth, environmental protection, and social justice, right? So there are resource conflicts, there are development conflicts, and there are property conflicts that have to be considered. So a really high complexity for achieving the goal of energy transition or a great challenge for energy transition. So I think it's important to keep that in mind, and just to give you one example, of course, energy poverty is also a topic in the city of Warsaw. We learned this specifically for the district of Praga, right? So which is not that well connected to the district heating network. So not all the households would have direct and cheap access to energy sources. So I think this is also an important topic when we talk about urban energy. So to make it now really short, urban energy transition, it's really an interaction between urban change and the transformation of energy system. This was in the center of our seminar, so to conceive energy transition also as a topic for urban transformation, right? And vice versa. So now I will quickly go through and give you some examples how we also now work in our seminars with the students. But first of all, let me quickly just remind you how we use this notion of ecologies or energy ecologies also. And I would like to most prominently refer to a number of books of the 1970s highlighting different cities, Chicago, as Boyarsky, or Rainer Banham, Los Angeles, or Kohlhaas, New York. And more specifically, Banham was really using this notion of urban ecology, right, to describe Los Angeles. So borrowing the concept from the urban sociologists from Chicago as they developed the concept at the beginning of the 20th century. So here's the content, and you can see the content of his book on Los Angeles. He basically highlighted four types of ecology, one on the beach area, so highlighting the surfing culture, then the foothills as a second ecology, a third ecology, the plains, and then, of course, the transportation network was also included. So which gives you a hint how we also try to think about the city. So ecologies not really following the legal boundaries of cities, right? They have a different logic, and I think that's the reason why it was so successful in this case, right? So a few examples taken from Banham's book on Los Angeles, Boyarsky highlighting Chicago, but then also artist works are important for our understanding. So doing ethnographic inquiries in the field, exploring the suburban areas like Robert Smithson and Carl André in the late 1960s, or most prominently also Peter Fend, an interdisciplinary artist, exploring the energy system of New York City, also trying to make proposals. So I think he worked in a similar way like you guys from Centrala are doing. So it's really about talking about the existing energy landscapes, but also possible future energy landscapes. So there's a kind of a pictorial representational dimension also in the students' works. And then the question, how can we describe the materiality, the practices and the processes related to energy systems? So, and I give you now the first example is Geneva, a few hints how we are exploring this in the frame of an exhibition that we presented at our university based also on students' work highlighting Geneva, the city as energy landscape, and we also so with a theoretical part here, and here's the overall layout of the exhibition, and then a second part highlighting Geneva. And in this theory part, you would see that we really try to kind of complement the focus on energy infrastructure with the focus on energy commons, so also including the urban fabric and the natural forces that we can find in a city like Geneva. we really try to kind of studying energy systems in relation also to urban change. I think this is the overall idea. As you will see, it's not only about technological issues. Of course, it's rather highlighting the complexity of the city, relying on ethnographic methods, we could say, and particularly also using films. They all filmed during their field studies, the students, and the output was, as I said, a video essay. So here are the sites explored by the students. Zelazna Brama was one settlement was explored, the old town, MDM district, then the district heating infrastructure, air conditioning infrastructure with a public character. Muranov was also one of the energy ecologies explored, then the sports complex Vajarvianka, then green roofs, the university library in particular, and Praga district. So these were kind of the energy ecologies explored by the students. As you can see, 9 groups developing a video essay. So I go now really quickly through it. District heating, Warsaw, and we will hear more about this in a few seconds. Then also the second video that we would like to show you is about a public type of air conditioning, a third one about the sports complex, and the fourth one that we will present here is the one about MDM district, and then there were another one about Muranov settlement, also the question of embodied energy, building materials that can be reused, right? Then so Selazna Brama estate was also rethought in terms of new microgrids. So as I already described it, and Praga was kind of explored in terms of energy poverty. And the green roofs were also explored in terms of maintenance, for instance, of this very complex infrastructure on top. And finally, also the old town has been a topic, again, focusing on embodied energy. So this is now the last slide, I think. So urban change and energy transition are interrelated for us. I think as architects, we have to develop a comprehensive approach to energy transition, always taking also the existing urban structure and infrastructure in mind. And so here are the students and their work. So I think Anna and Maria will now, you will see now first of all the movie of Anna and Maria, and then followed by Justin and Luigi's video, followed by Davide and Kasper's film, and then at the end Lukas and Matilde's video. So as you can see, we had also 2 Polish students, right?
So
I'm really happy that we also had 2 Polish students within the group. I think it was also kind of helping to enrich the debates. So I think that's it from my side, and I think we will immediately now continue with the videos. It's 4 times 10 minutes, so I really hope you enjoyed.
Thank you.
but there's a place when they heat water and they use these pipes to go through the Warsaw, and there this main pipe, and we have a place like this. This is our room in the underground, and from that room there is a small parts go through different buildings. In each building there is a specific room where it goes through every flat.
Is it correct that you use coal to heat the water?
The desert, 110 by day, cool enough to need heat the same night. The maximum test for air conditioning. What system works best? Let's ask the owner of this desert showplace, Miss Dinah Shore.
Hi. For my dream home in Palm Springs, I wanted the best, and that's gas. Gas cooling is as wonderful as gas heat, and so dependable. It's simple and has a long life. With my year-round gas air conditioning by Arkla, I just touch the thermostat for delightful cooling or comfortable heat in every room. Humidity controlled, dust and pollen filtered. My indoor climate is always perfect. And so is my neighbor's, Bing Crosby. He has gas air conditioning, too. America's most modern homes choose gas. Go to your gas company or contractor. Your family can enjoy gas air conditioning by Arkla this summer. Remember, you can live modern for less with gas.
The climate region in which Warsaw is located following the Köppen climate classification is oceanic, humid with warm summer with occasional tropical heat wave and mild winter, but due to the location and the absence of mountain in the east, we find it influenced by the humid continental, which consists in hot and humid summer and freezing cold winters.
The sun is shining more and more, and you need to drink more water. It's also no good for the accordion, because in the sun, the wax inside can melt. It used to be different in the past. It was a bit cooler. People change, and the climate is changing too.
With the meeting of this two distinct climate and the urban heat island effect, in which cities became warmer during the summer thanks to heat-absorbing material like asphalt in the city, we can expect a wide thermal range between summer and winter, from a mean minimum temperature of minus 17 degrees to a mean maximum of 33 degrees, temperatures that, at least in summer, due to climate change, will continue to rise. In this context, we are seeing the spreading of air conditioning that is appearing in more and more buildings. This technology is used for controlling the temperature of multiple spaces, permits the dehumidification and the cooling, exchanging heat between different sources, mainly air but not only. This technology is evolving to radiating it in the ground or water, not to contribute to the already warm outside air. As written in Lost in Wall by Van Leeuwen, a book set in the Jakarta of the 90s, air condition is not used mainly for temperature comfort, as it is also a symbol for being part in a middle-class society. The book tells that with multiple small story, the daily life of middle-class citizen and their commodities. We understand that there is also a social and class motivation to its spread, and that air-conditioned space must only be public to prevent class discrimination. After analyzing different city, we find that the only way a low class can afford the feeling of an air-conditioned space is to buy something in a shop, as we can see here in Berlin. The only way the lower classes can afford it without being forced to buy something is to strive creating inefficient but usable solution.
I cannot live another day without air conditioning.
Says tomorrow's gonna be hotter.
Hotter?
Like yesterday.
Yesterday?
Yesterday you said you'd call Sears.
I'll call today.
You call now.
I'll call now.
Now's the time to save on Sears installed central air conditioning.
The sites we are going to analyze is the Zlotarazi Shopping Center and the Warsaw Central Station. These two buildings were constructed in two different periods with a different purpose. The station is the main connecting point of Warsaw. It connects the city with the surrounding city and the other European capitals. Due to the strategic place of the area, the city center autonomous district and ING Real Estate in 2002 decided to build the shopping center, transforming the station too in a commercial space. This phenomenon of privatizing commercialized public spaces is not only related to our site. After analyzing the area, we discover that the same thing is happening all around the city. So we decided to expand our analysis to all the connection places in Warsaw. We start to imagine a city composed by small self-sufficient district, with all the service in which everything is reachable by foot, and at the center of which there is a connecting space. We found a multitude untouched connection, all of them reachable by foot that can be transformed in the meeting places for this autonomous district, erasing the need of a city-scale shopping mall, as already recognized by Peter Rainer Banham, in his famous book Los Angeles, The Architecture of Four Ecologies, written in 1971, he noted that the development of accessible air-conditioned spaces with the most controlled climate is happening and growing in the linking spaces of the city. In those spaces we imagine the presence of small energy-sufficient air-conditioned bubble for everyone to enjoy independently of their economical background. Not all the founded spaces are immediately accessible. In fact, some of them are transformed in parking lot. The process would be to re-transform this areas in green area with vegetation that in summer can absorb the heat and shade the bubbles, reducing the energy need. Also, we would imagine the application of technologies like ground heat dispersion as to not warm the area surrounding the spaces. We start to research about the feasibility of our project, and we found an article by Bloomberg about a similar strategy in Singapore. Even thought, this plan is on a different scale. The government backed the project for building Garden by the Bay, a massive greenhouse bubble with a constant 24 degree, surrounded inside and outside by vegetation, and is nearby the densest part of the city to be reachable by foot. And everything is cooled by an underground cooling system that is also connected to the nearby city district. This same research point out that until 2050, without solution, people will continue to buy house with old refrigeration unit that are massively inefficient and will increase the temperature, creating an unstoppable cycle in which 15% of the world energy will be spent to cool the cities around the globe.
Thank you.
proszę Państwa, za chwilę rozpocznie się finałowy mecz turnieju o złotą piłkę. Gwizdek sędziego, gra rozpoczęta. Dwie najlepsze drużyny, Syrenka i Polonia, dostąpiły dziś zaszczytu grania na tym wielkim stadionie w przedmeczu międzypaństwowego spotkania Polska-Włochy.
Jedną z takich naszych lubianych przez nas prac była zespół sportowy Warszawianka na Mokotowie. Wzięliśmy tę pracę z konkursu jako pierwszą nagrodę.
We are a man-centered society. We have never learned that we are a part of nature. Show me any civilization that believes that reality exists only because man can perceive it, that the cosmos was erected to support man on its pinnacle, that man exclusively is divine, and then I will predict the nature of its cities and its landscape, the hot dog stands, the neon shill, the ticky-tacky houses, the sterile core, the mind and ravaged countryside. This is the image of anthropocentric man. He seeks not unity with nature, but conquest. Yet unity he finds. When his arrogance and ignorance are still and he lies dead.
You live in that area where the ice sheets came and went, and they have left a mark. And so we've got to know about superficial geology, because they have modified historical geology. If you know about climate, historical geology, and physiography, and superficial geology, you know about physiography, because that just happens to be the current state of the world's surface as a result of these ongoing processes. If you know about climate, geology, bedrock geology, superficial geology, and physiography, then you know about hydrology. And if you know about the movements of water, then you know about soils. If you know about soils, then you can understand the distribution of plants.
Zarówno w murze, jak i w tym zboczu mamy interpretację ziemi. Ja bym powiedział, że jest to sztuka ziemi. Nie jest to naturalizm, tylko jest to sztuka ziemi. Wydaje mi się, że ten semantyczny przekaz, który tu odbieramy, nie został jeszcze właściwie odkryty.
Wow.
Trzeba sobie wyobrazić tu tłumy, powiedzmy, na stadionie, tutaj, powiedzmy, biegających sportowców i masa elementów ruchomych.
Boże. Jednak to jest trochę zanadto zniszczone, żeby można było odczytać i zamiary i jakieś ewentualne osiągnięcia.
The realization of these ideas is not going to be easy. Most people fail to understand that land which deserves protection is best protected by leaving it in its natural state,
They tend to think that any open space ought to be developed into parks.
When you provide parks, you aren't just acquiring property, you're developing. Well, certainly you're going to have some type of a highway system to these areas. In using equipment to develop the parks, you're building roads, you're cutting down bluffs.
Dear God. It seems to me that one really needs to have two things. You want not only be able to say don't, but you also want to be able to say do. To be able to stand up to any developer and say, friend, I know about the last time. Man, you really made a shambles. The house has slid down the hill. You've got a number of them here. And somebody sued you. You know, you don't want that to happen again. And the man said, I certainly don't. He said, well, you just come to me. I'll tell you where, you know. We've got this map. It'll tell you the areas where you can get the best of all possible foundations, where you can guarantee to have dry basements, where indeed the recreational resources are inordinately attractive to prospective development. And so you then are engaged in a positive inducement process in which developers are trooping in here, asking to find out places where development is most fitting for every function, be it an atomic power station or an airport or a new town. It doesn't matter what it is. But the only thing you can ask is nature.
W stosunku do tego zbocza, które tu Państwo istnieje, ono jak gdyby jest dominujące, w stosunku, ja bym powiedział, w przenośni, że jest to ziemia, wokół której kręci się świat. I dlatego istnieje tam kawiarnia z tamtej strony, tam boiska tenisowe po drugiej stronie, tam z kolei jeszcze coś, jeszcze słowem, cały kombinat. Natomiast utrzymuje w równowadze właśnie ta forma niesłychanie czytelna i bardzo tak no klarownie zdefiniowana. Ja bym powiedział kubistycznie, bo ma sezanowsko.
Ma rację, ma rację. Tak, tak. Ale to jest... Jest tragedia, to jest pokazanie tragedii.
So that's where it belongs.
But where is it collected from? You need the sun.
you enjoyed watching the movies. We will have now the opportunity to for a short discussion. I would like to invite our guests from the seminar, but also Agnieszka, is that correct? Yeah, please. And Lukasz also join us, one of the students, former students actually. And yeah, let's have a seat here. You can sit here. There's a, yeah. Is there a possibility to see the students or the audience, the online audience, or is there any? No, it's not possible. So unfortunately not. Of course, we wanted to also connect our students, which should be online. Unfortunately, it didn't work out tonight. But anyhow, so I'm happy that we can now share maybe some thoughts, observations from your side. Of course, we're curious to hear what your reflections are. Maybe, Agnieszka, can I invite you to simply share some observations and please present very quickly your role also in the frame of the city.
Yeah, thank you for the invitation. I'm here on behalf of the City Hall of Warsaw, the Department of Urban Planning, and our team is working on the project that you see here all around the place, here and downstairs. This is the new general plan of Warsaw, and my role in it is taking care of the environment and a technical infrastructure. So I'm dealing with these issues and landscape as well. So I'm dealing with these issues that we just saw. And I think these four films perfectly focused on four main challenges for Warsaw. First is the decarbonization of the heating network, which is the largest in the European community. Do you know how long is it?
No?
Yeah, it's 1,700 kilometers, so big thing. And we have, as you said, four power and heating plants. Two of them are combined and two of them are just heating plants, but one is sort of a spur plant, not used every time, you know, it's plugged in when it's needed. And the issue of ownership that you mentioned here is the other way around. I mean, the power plants, the power heating plants are owned by the state and the state company, and the pipes are owned by the private companies. And this is the issue of cooperation between private and state companies, sort of partnership. The problem is that this heating network is getting old. It's 50 years old or so, or more, 60 or so. And now we are facing the challenge of the transition. And what do we do with such a huge network, you know? It's a big question for us. And how do we address that in the future? Because most of the buildings are powered by that network. And we somehow have to, of course, reduce our ecological footprint and use renewable energy sources that will be scattered around the city. But what do we do with that huge network? It's a big issue for the future, I think. And the other films pointed very important issues. Air conditioning actually is using more energy than heating now. So we are using more energy in the summer rather than in the winter. And the systems of air conditioning in the buildings are independent and mostly powered by the electricity. So maybe this could be addressed somehow, and these buildings could also produce the energy, as you shown us in the fourth film. And the third film was very interesting, as it was about the role of blue-green infrastructure in the city. And we also focused on that in our general plan. So I think these are the main issues we face nowadays. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Adam, you want to maybe continue? Also quickly introduce yourself, just two sentences.
Yeah, just two sentences. I mean, I'm an architecture historian working on a post-war reconstruction of Warsaw and on rubble, so more materiality. But exactly as you said, Sasha, in the context of materials and materiality and the city as we see it, we have to see it through the energy which went into materials which we are surrounded by. So, for example, to consider that this building built from concrete and steel is full of carbon, which was sequestered in those materials through production. And I think, and so at the same time, it really kind of this image of air conditioner, like build up in an apartment in Warsaw really spoke to me, because now I'm also working on a issue of windows and reuse of windows in the reconstruction of Ukrainian cities. And I think this really have showed us how those individual I know that we need to kind of, there is this issue of moving to the bigger scale, but also we need to remember exactly on about this individual scale and the energy poverty not connected only to heating, but also in the context, as you said, of Warsaw transferring to a different climate conditions, to energy poverty in terms of air conditioning and access to air conditioning. And I think it was really inspiring, those films and this research is really inspiring, because it also shows us that nature, like you will talk about designing more with nature, but I'm thinking that this energy, this coal and production of energy and consumption of energy is also part of our relation with nature. So this came up with harvesting the city. So the idea of, I really like that idea in second movie or third movie, that the city is a place of harvesting of energy and should be considered as such. So this gives you another view on that. But I guess the reflection now, when I'm, because there is a big discussion in the context of materials about closing the loop, about circular economy, and this is a debate which comes out specifically in the corporate environments in Warsaw, like of the big office buildings trying to reach the certificates. And I think in a more like reaching to a collective, not only in terms of corporations, but rather to a collective of people and inhabitants, it's really a challenge which needs to be faced. Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Simone.
I am Simone from Centrala, co-partner together with Mogrzata Takuciewicz. First of all, I would like to compliment the students, because the work is really impressive. They really went too deep into research and also combined that with historical materials, which is, I think, a fantastic way to actually make the message strong. And I think one of the, personally, you know, beside, of course, the Warszawianka episode, which we feel kind of responsible of partially because of introducing the subject to the students, I was really impressed and interested in the one about air conditioning, because of like subject that we touched upon, like by conversation with Sasha regarding like mostly democratizing access to coolness, and how in fact this is an interesting topic, and how maybe representative from the city administrations such as Agnieszka can enlighten us on how make accessible buildings for the cooling properties, for the natural cooling properties, in absence of like an idea of consumerism, for instance. Like we often talked about how underused like churches are in cities, and that could be like a network of cooling infrastructure, for instance, because of the thermal mass that the walls are able to retain. But also another subject that we loved regarding like the So that this double aspect of the air conditioning is like the heat that they actually emit, and now this creates sort of like thermal injustice because they emit heat into neighboring buildings, and now this heat should be kind of vexed at least by the taxed in a way or harvested in some way and kind of like rebalanced. So I think that the, of course, like, you know, this the air conditioning, and also because of what you mentioned of the energy consumption that is even higher than the one in the winter, it's like it's kind of like a subject that I feel like it's kind of like strong and important to tackle at the moment.
Yes, it's true that the films are very like it was a great inspiration for me, and actually it opened up so many questions about my own city that I'm a bit overwhelmed. But okay, some few. Maybe I will start from the last one, because I know that in the socialistic times they even had a term which was called helioplastika, so like a sun plasticity, that they used to create all that massive sculptures. That they were analyzing the this complex, but for the aesthetic purposes, for the like they knew that it's symmetrical, but it never will be the same because one part of that square is always in the shadow. But so it's I mean, there are simple rules in nature, like, I don't know, sunlight, but different, you know, a few decades, and we have completely different approach, which is a very, like, a fresh, like, reading of that structure. So I, as well, like Simone said, I'm now full of questions about all the wasteful energy consumption in Warsaw, about all the these thermal junks that we have, and about mapping, like, for example, that passive common spaces that we could use in the hot summers. And one thing is that I heard that already market is there is a response on the housing market, because now more and more are popular the flats with the North Exposition. So before it was one of the assets that the South Exposition, but now the those flats which were never popular, they started to be popular because of their like cooler. So I think that this long shadow casted by the high skyscrapers can be read in the future as well as something very attractive. So
a blessing.
Thanks, Lukas. Do you want to join the discussion? Maybe also sharing some reflections about the seminar and the approach of the seminar, that you are now a trained architect, graduated architect, and how will you maybe continue to explore the topic of energy in cities? Well, what are maybe the main sources that you will use in the future?
I think, first of all, this seminar, this exercise was a great opportunity to reach tools which are dropping from this exclusivity and this overwhelming complexity of this topic. This tool which we use, this video essay, and maybe sometimes we approach this topic with from the sort of naive level without any knowledge. It's recalling me the program which is actually going on now in Switzerland, Artists in Labs, that they are actually inviting artists in very professional laboratories. And those artists sometimes, with their totally different bottom-up approach, are making a lot of openings to these researchers, which were so focused and close-minded in this very complex laboratory staff, that they couldn't perceive new openings, new lines. And I think this method we reach, I think, is giving me actually a hope that these overwhelming problems can be reached from the different point of view. This is one thing. And another thing is always great to get this view from abroad for the own city, like Gosia said, like because sometimes we again so used to the view of everyday streets and buildings that we sometimes need to step out and perceive it. And in the end, I think it's giving a bit bigger pressure on practice, that there is way much more to consider than architecture itself, that this profession is and it will be never again so simple to make it just a building. To be always aware of the wider context.
I of course fully agree. I think there is another level of complexity. Meanwhile, also different scales that have to be addressed at the same time. Also talking about climate issues, of course, it's not the building alone which is relevant for architects today. Maybe I also include the audience. Anna Ptak is also with us. Maybe you can just share some thoughts. You were also one of our guides during the last year's seminar in Warsaw. So can you maybe add some comments or observations? You are also involved as a researcher with energy topics, and I think it's particularly interesting to hear just some observations.
Thanks for inviting me to the conversation. However, I'm a bit kind of shy to do so since, not coming from the métier of architecture, it's kind of, difficult to get into the conversation because of the complexity of the issues that are being dealt with within the building matter itself. However, from the point of view of energy landscape or energy challenges of war. So I really liked how the four topics actually were able to, the four essays were able to kind of show Warsaw through a different cross-section that we usually look at. And so this the fact that this combination of the four allow us to think about how the matters that we usually take as not connected are connected. This is very interesting, and I think that the power of this kind of, architectural ethnographic work is something that helps us to reimagine a little bit how the different layers of the cities are connected. And I enjoyed that. That's one thing. Another thing is that I think that the Warsaw doesn't have the problematized issue between its outside, that Warsaw is being very much thought of by its inhabitants, but by its rulers as kind of self-contained entity, and the subject of energy flows, the supply chains, and the climate itself maybe are the areas within we cannot think about the city this way anymore. And I'm curious, where are these ways in the politics, for example, of the city development, where we can think about not response, like about the city as an actor within the let's say global or even national politics that is related to, I don't know, climate justice and things like that. So that's something that I find interesting thanks to this focus. And I still think that this microethnographic studies that could be kind of pushed forward, would kind of give more detail to the stories that were told by the students. I know that the language barrier and the shortness of the stay probably was something that wouldn't allow for that, but this I understand the emphasis on interconnectedness and the city as a kind of superstructure within the subject of energy. However, correlating it always with certain social formations is something that I find relevant. And it's very general what I'm speaking about, but that's something that kind of came to my mind while watching it. And last but not least, I think that fact that I have to gather my thoughts, but the prime energy sources here in Warsaw, the natural gas, the coal, the sun, the labor involved in that. These are interesting topics that are still not very much present in the city debates, and I would like to see it more. And thank you for bringing these topics here.
Thanks a lot for these relevant and interesting comments. So maybe we can have a last round of discussion and then really coming to an end. Using a main hypothesis of this seminar, making the city more productive in terms of energy also, not only, but also. So from a realistic point of view, so what do you see as a possible next step, or what will happen in the next 5 or 10 years related to energy transition and net zero emissions goals, let's say? What is kind of a promising path that the city can take as a strategy, let's say?
The city of Warsaw is going to be climate neutral by 2050. And it's a really big challenge in terms of what we just saw here, yeah? But we are on the way. And in this general plan for the city, we take the path of decarbonization. As you said, we want both main heating and power plants to be powered by gas. But that doesn't depend on us, as these networks, gas networks, and both the power plants are owned by the state. So, but the state is doing it. It's under construction. The one is already powered by gas, and the other one is under construction. So, it's being done. And what do we do? We want to focus on renewable energy sources, and in the general plan, we stated that in general, the sources like biogas, hydrogen, and stuff like that can be used in the whole city, as well as the heating pumps. And about the photovoltaics, we specified some areas where these, farms, photovoltaic farms, we call that here, that can be developed. And this is about the landscape. This is a big landscape issue because it takes a lot of space and it changes the landscape and makes a big impact. So we had to really map it and to specify the places where it doesn't harm the landscape too much. And these are the industrial spaces, these are some transportation hubs or parking lots, as we saw on the film, and roofs. And on the roofs, these panels can be installed. And I think the new technologies are coming, and we still don't know what they are like. But for sure, those will have to be integrated with the architecture, because we have a lot of historic buildings And it's not easy, you know, to fix just a panel on the wall and make it like, I don't know if you know, like, it was with satellite antennas in the past that we had them everywhere. And just we saw the air conditioners everywhere, and we just don't want the solar panels everywhere. So we have to start thinking about it, how to integrate that with the architecture, as well as the historical architecture and the modern architecture. So there are really many challenges, and I think there is a lot of work both for architects and engineers, because the buildings have to be adjusted to use their renewable energy sources. This huge heating network is for high temperatures, and the renewables are for the low temperatures, and these are totally different installations in the building. So really a lot of work. Hope we'll get a lot of that done by 2050. Let's see.
Thank you so much. Maybe Adam, also from your point of view, you are of course a historian, but now more and more dealing with the reuse of building materials in the context of your historical research that you have undertaken. So how do you see that related to Warsaw, let's say? Yeah. Well, what is kind of the potential? Also with this focus on cities, is that an interesting scale still? Or is it kind of, do we also have to adjust the scale in a certain way?
Yeah, I was thinking like one thing what Anna suggested about the connection between Warsaw, the periphery, and or even not periphery, but hinterland and the city. And I think this is a crucial angle which is not which is visible historically and not really palpable on an everyday basis. But Warsaw is not only built on coal, but from the perspective of the Warsaw reconstruction after the war, it was all powered by coal. Like Polish government was able to buy technologies by anything on the international scale, only because of the coal, which could be produced in Silesia. So this connection between Silesia and Warsaw, which is also well represented by the railways, which are, you know, the fast connection railways during the communist times. Other angle is that of, you know, building materials coming from the Western territories to Warsaw and, you know, coal inside those materials, so the bricks, German bricks building Warsaw, and the MDM, for example. I think this is quite interesting how that works, but I would say in terms of energy, when I'm thinking about energy, exactly the scale of the state, like of international trade also with coal, and like, you know, it's not that the Polish coal mines are the only ones providing coal for heating of Warsaw. If I'm not an expert on that, but I guess it's an international kind of issue where that comes from, and it's a global kind of trade. So it's quite interesting to also see it in those global terms of consumption as well, because those corporate firms, for example, building high-rises in Warsaw, which have a huge consumption but claim to be like zero emission because of the certificates. And this brings me to another angle, which is not heating, because recently I was visiting some conference about windows, the industry, window industry, and there was a quite interesting point which was also made in the film by the worker installing the pipes, that it's not only about the it's not only about the source of the heating, but also about the insulation, about maintenance of pipes. And this is something which we, you know, me not being an architect, it's an unusual thing to think about, that this inside and outside connection is really crucial, and how windows and how new technologies are mediating between inside and outside. And I think this is a crucial axis here, an angle to think about urban life, basically, that buildings are more and more insulated from the outside, and what this means.
Okay. Thank you so much, Gosha and Simone. You also have a quite comprehensive understanding of productivity in the city, so not only from an energy perspective, but certainly also. So, how do you see that Warsaw in 20 years or 30 years? What would be your vision?
Actually, I think that like our most recent line of work is very much connected with this dichotomy you highlighted in your presentation, in this strong relationship between like actually climate and energy landscape, in a way in which like we need to kind of balance between like energy infrastructures and climate commons. Basically, what on how like the so-called green blue and infrastructure or nature can help us in moderating our energy consumption. Recently, with Gosha in a team composed by art historians and landscape designers, we studied the history of the reconstruction of Warsaw from the point of view of landscape, and how incredible modern landscape designers helped in shaping the city that we have today, and how. And in doing so, moderating also its climate in several of its parts, in designing urban forests, freshwater bodies of water with their cooling properties, and so on and so forth. Recently, we've been advocating for the protection of urban wetlands as an incredible source of CO2 carbon capture and moderating climate change. So, in a sense, like the way we see the future of Warsaw is of an integrated sort of like performance in which the mechanical kind of reduces its necessity to be productive in favor of a landscape that actually helps us in dealing with the changes that the future this kind of like awaits for us.
You want to compliment?
I think that we have a task in front of us, Simon and me, in like creating a shift in language about our resources in the city. Of course, we have this type of interest that these unplugged solutions are the most tempting to like map or to mediate. We discussed, for example, with the city conservatory, why they electrified and why they plugged all the monuments to the systems. We cannot feel the coldness of the castles anymore. And they promised to us that we can discuss, for example, a new type of the heritage, which is a microclimatic heritage, because we know that we have Grotto in Warsaw. It's now actually in the planning procedure. It's next to Święta Katarzyna Church, which was the king's ice storage. Now it's protected because it's a natural protection, because it's a house of bats. But it's the only monument that probably that we have, which was not plugged to the systems, and maybe we can enjoy it in the summers as this unplugged bubble of cooler place. So the topic of the second movie, yes. So I think that this shift in language of the citizens, because there is discomfort and there is a luxury that we need to discuss, and I think that the we need to of course to open much more into the not luxurious solutions.
Yeah, like low-tech solutions, I guess this is... Yeah.
No, because I was scared by this fact that, it can be considered in the connection with the status, and we have this cabrio cars with the that you can use still the bubble of the I
air conditioning.
And what is important for me, I think it's low-tech solutions and also nature-based solutions. And for, thank you, Simone, for mentioning that, because the role of the nature in the city is huge, and we actually treat it as an equal with the other systems, with the technical systems and with the buildings. It's not a spare part that we can use for further construction. No, it makes a big role, and these are the ecosystem services, and this is the way we understand the role of nature in the city, and this is the way how we approach it. So for us, the blue-green infrastructure is an overall system in the city, and it, these are forests, these are parks, these are little gardening plots and stuff like that. These are natural areas, and these are also green roofs on tops of the buildings and our objects like green walls, like we see here, or stuff like that. Yeah, so we have to use many solutions for that, and I think that helps to mitigate the climate change, and that makes a big difference if we use it as a mass solution. Thank you.
Thanks. Last word for Lukasz. As a young architect, of course, also having the future in view, so to speak. Now, I'm curious to hear how you now see the possibility to start also to work independently as an architect in Warsaw. What are topics of interest from your perspective? We talked a lot about general concepts, of course, overall strategies, but what could be now a next step from your perspective? What is in your personal interest?
I think all those aspects, and as Gosha said, is we need the change of the language, but this change and the transition, energy transition, cannot be made without the people, because we cannot just make a law and impose it on the people, because this is dealing with down-creasing the comfort of the people, right? Like energy transition and this change of the law will deal with probably change of the common and current state of comfort of the people, individual comfort, if we are talking about the air conditioning and so on. So I'm just wondering if, for example, we have housing cooperatives, maybe it's possible that there somehow these housing cooperatives will be also energy cooperatives, or we will have some kind of ideas that not only by a state, but people will start to make it work on themselves and interesting for themselves. Like, let's make our cooperative, let's make our housing energy efficient. Maybe it's can be something interesting for the people and the community of individual housings. Maybe we can create this transition and architecture by ideas for the people. Not only by designing and again inclusively talking about it, but creating some kind of solution for the housing cooperatives.
Yeah. I just wanted to add to this that we should it's important also not to overlook what's actually there. Like, I think many cooperatives, like, we are speaking here in terms of climate and everything, but the actual discussions are in terms exactly of changing windows or changing heating systems to ones which are more efficient or more environmental friendly or allowed by the state. And in the end, a lot is happening around that. And I think exactly with those cooperatives, they look for more efficient, more economically viable options. And I think it's important also to look how it looks like now. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm very curious to kind of follow up on this discussion. In Switzerland, we have this comprehensive tradition of housing cooperatives. Of course, I don't know how that works in Warsaw or in Poland in general. But I would like to stop here. Thank you so much for your comments. Thank you, Zodiac Pavilion for Architecture. It was a pleasure to be here. We had some technical problems, unfortunately, and couldn't include the students. But I think for me personally, it was really now a pleasure to make a next step after our seminar in Warsaw and continue the discussion with all of you. And yeah, I hope there will be more occasions to share thoughts about energy issues. So thanks a lot for being with us. Thank you.